Okay, good morning. So we are moving on to a more technical part now. In these three lectures today, I want to describe for you the instability of flames. So I want to go through this analysis of the instability of flames. So the first instability, the main one, the major instability, is an hydrodynamical instability. And in order to study the main, the essential process of this instability, it is sufficient to consider the flame as an hydrodynamical discontinuity. What does that mean? This means that we are considering wrinkles of the flame, which have a much larger wavelength than the flame thickness, so that you may consider the flame as infinitely thin without thickness at all. So the flame is considered as a surface of zero thickness, separating two incompressible flow. And because we are dealing with low Mach number flow, that means flow with velocity which is much smaller than the sound, the speed of sound, we are going to use the Euler equation. By the way, it's not so clear why we can neglect the viscous effect, but we are going to neglect the viscous effect and just to pick up the dominant phenomena. So here I have written here the Euler equation, and this is the Lagrangian form of the Euler equation using the particulate derivative, but it's for the next the few next slides, it will be better to use this Euler formulation, which is equivalent to the Lagrangian formulation when you used the continuity equation. So now let me consider, I want to first describe what are the jump conditions across such a thin flame, wrinkled thin flames. So I consider a tilde planar front, you see, and the position x and z, I work in two dimensions. X is the transverse, is longitudinal, and z is a transverse direction. And the component in this reference frame here, attached to the tilt flame, are u and w. U is the normal component of the upstream flow, for example, or downstream, in the upstream side, and w is a tangential component. And this equation, this equation here, when you, this one and this one, the continuity equation here, written in 2D, I write in 2D just for saving the notation, but this, you can extend that immediately to 3D. It's not a big problem. This is very easy. But for saving the notation, I work in 2D. So here is a continuity equation. And here is two components written in the Eulerian form of the Euler equation here. Now, I want to integrate this equation across the flame just to obtain the jump of the quantity across the thing. Now, you see, because I am considering the limit where the thickness goes to zero, every integration, an integration across this when of any quantity which is regular, that means that has no that is continuous and no singular, it will give zero. So now, if a quantity has a jump across, this jump is similar to an either side function, you know, a step function, like that. And so the derivative is singular, is a delta function. So the derivative is giving every term, any term that has not a derivative along the normal direction will give zero, except the derivative in the normal direction, because when you integrate a derivative in the normal, you find the value, the difference of the value on both sides. So it's easy. So the game is easy to play. And the first equation here, there is only this term. When you integrate, you have the jump of the long of the normal mass flux, rho u, which should be the same on both sides, conservation of mass, nothing else. Then you are on the on this normal direction here, of this equation here, of the x component of the momentum, conservation of the momentum here, you have only this term coming from this here that plays, that you have to take into account. And this gives you the jump of p plus rho u square, which should be the same on both sides. Okay? So this gives, it's not a jump because it is the same value on both sides, but this gives you the jump of the pressure in terms of the jump of the velocity. Because rho u is constant, it's the same on both sides, not rho u square, rho u, but not rho u square. So you have a jump of u, a jump of p, and both are related by this relation. Interesting enough is the transverse component of the momentum. You know, the only quantity which you have to take into account is this term here. But in this term, you know that rho u is constant. So you take rho u out from the derivative and you integrate. And this tells you that the tangential component of the velocity is conserved. So these are the basic jump relation across a plane. I just want to emphasize that in order to obtain the third relation here, I have assumed that rho u is not constant, it's not zero. Because if it is zero, you do not find any relation concerning the tangential velocity. So this is important when you deal with an interface that has no mass crossing across, you do not have this relation. This relation, that conservation of the tangential velocity, result from the fact that you have a non-zero mass flux across the flame. Okay? So this is important when we want to compare flame to other interfaces. So this is typical of flames or shock or any surface across which the matter is crossing. All right. So here are the jump across hydrodynamic discontinuity. In order to illustrate the hydrodynamic effect, which is that the hydrodynamic effects are, you know, here I have this, I have a sketch of a planar plane written in the reference frame of the frame front. You see? Now, the flow the fresh flow arrive with a velocity UL, laminar flame velocity, which is the velocity of propagation of a flame if the gas is at rest, you know? This is the flame velocity. Now you have the burned gas escape from this interface with a different velocity because you have a difference of temperature, and because you have a difference of temperature and because you are isothermal, okay, you have a difference of velocity. Rho U constant, rho T is constant, so the ratio of U is in the ratio of temperature. Okay, this is easy to understand. So the gas which is less dense, the burned gas, escape faster just to conserve the mass. Okay? All right. And this effect, the density difference, is very, very important. For example, to illustrate this importance, let's consider here, two cases. One on the top, the flame is, I assume it is a planar, as you will see, it's never planar, but just to understand. You ignite the flame in a tube at the open end, okay? And so that the gas, on the fresh gas is has no motion. Why? Because this boundary here prevents the gas to move. It's a quiet gas. It cannot move so this gas is at rest. The fresh mixture is at rest. So the flame propagates with in the tube with the flame velocity, what is called the flame velocity. Now, when you consider the burned gas, you have the difference between this burn velocity, which is related to the flame velocity by the ratio of temperature, minus the velocity of propagation of the flame. And this, you know, the gas go outside, the burned gas escape outside at this velocity, which is positive, UB minus UL, because UB is larger than the UL, the ratio. The ratio is the ratio of the density. So now consider just a different experiment. What you do, you ignite the flame at the closed end. Now, the closed end makes the burned gas to be quiet. They cannot move because you are in it is an incompressible flow, so it cannot escape. So the burned gas is at rest. But if the burned gas is at rest, now the flame should propagate with the burned gas velocity here, this one in this laboratory, in this frame here. So it propagates in the laboratory frame with the velocity of the burned gas in this frame, all right? Much faster than in that case. The ratio, again, is the ratio of the temperature, right? Okay, now, and so when you sit here on the flame, you see the burned gas going out at the velocity UB because it is, the burned gas is at rest, but the flame moves. So you have a relative velocity, which is UB, okay? And this is why the flame is going at propagates at the velocity UB, something like six, seven times faster than the laminar flame speed. But now, and this is a very important effect, now the fresh mixture should cross the flame at the velocity UL, all right? This means that the gas, fresh gas, should be put in motion toward the open end at a velocity equal to UB minus UL. So that the flame move at UB, the gas move at UB minus UL in front of the flame, so that the difference is UL. And you recover this picture. But this is very important. Why? Because all the column of gas here is put in motion. And this will play, you know, this is a piston effect. The flame acts as a semi-permeable, is that English? I don't know. So I forgot to apologize for my broken English, but you noticed that already, so. okay. So this effect, you know, shows that the flame hydrodynamic effect, this effect illustrated a very strong hydrodynamical effect, which is here called as a piston effect. You know, a flame is a semi-permeable piston effect. Okay, now let's consider a tilted front. Because the front is tilted, I know that the transverse component should be conserved on both sides, and that the normal component should be in the ratio of the temperature. So you have a deflection of streamline across a tilted front, okay? This deflection of streamline, it is similar like those who did, who took course in optics. When you have the light, you know, the refraction of the light ray in two medium where the velocity of the light is different. Okay, it's a similar physical mechanism. All right? Okay, so we have to keep it now. Because you have a deviation of the streamline across the front, you have an instantaneous modification of the flow field on both sides, upstream and downstream. But what does that mean, instantaneous? This is not possible. It is the limit of low Mach number effect. In fact, any perturbation propagates with the speed of sound. But in our approximation of low Mach number approximation, the speed of sound is infinite. So this is why, in this limit, every time you wrinkle flame, you are inducing instantaneously modification of the flow in front, behind, because of the deflection of the velocity due to the change of density. Very simple. Now, if you look a little bit closer to this picture, you will understand immediately that this picture is unstable. Why? Look at the flow field here upstream. The streamline, because of the deflection, are diverging. Okay? So the flow, now, you know, I start from this planar situation and I wrinkle, all right? So I have at infinite, minus infinity, I have UL. But because the streamlines are diverging like that, the flow, and I am incompressible, the flow velocity in A here is smaller than UL. Ah, yes, but the flame does not like that. The flame wants to see a flow crossing it with a velocity UL. So what is going to do? It's going to propagate upstream to compensate this difference of velocity. You understand? And same thing on the other side. B is going downward. And you may apply this reasoning either upwards or downwards, it's the same, it works in the same way. And now you understand immediately that the flame is unstable. You, without any calculation, you can guess the result. Without any calculation, you will see the calculation are involved, but without calculation, I want to show you the result. You know, in this problem, let's consider a dimensional analysis. What do you have in this problem? Velocity, UL or UB. You have a wavelength, lambda, this is what you impose to your wrinkle, and nothing else. There is no thickness because it is the limit of the thickness is zero of the top. So how to construct a growth rate with that? There is only one way. Here it is. The growth rate should be the laminar flame velocity divided by the wavelength. So now you understand that this is a very strong instability. Why? Because shorter is the wavelength, stronger is instability. So something must become wrong when the wavelength become of the order of the flame thickness. I have neglected the flame thickness. But you see, this is a very, very strong instability. And it is very, I like to tell you this story. This instability was discovered by a French engineer. You know Darieux, les éoliennes Darieux. You know how do you saw this, the wind, how do you
wind turbine?
There are some very, very nice wind turbines that you can see in California, where the axis is vertical. And the turbine is so that it is well oriented, whatever be the direction of the wind. You know, this was invented by this man Darieux. He was French, and this man also did a calculation to understand the stability of flame. Okay, 1938, never published. Just a few notes that you can work to find in the but it never really published, okay? It was just in a journal, a very strange journal, okay. But Landau, the great physicist Landau, in 1945, did the calculation. And it is very interesting to read his paper, and especially to read the last sentence. He noticed that the instability is so strong. And he said, this cannot work. It's so strong that the flame should become turbulent. He said, it is so strong that you cannot, that something has to appear which is like a turbulent flame. So the flame should be naturally turbulent. And Zeldovich, who was, as I present Zeldovich yesterday, Zeldovich write a small sentence in his book. He said, if Landau has gone more often to laboratory, he should have seen flames that are not turbulent. So these people are kidding. So, but this is just to tell you how surprising is the strong, how strong is the strong instability of this hydrodynamical nature. So now I am going to do the calculation. For what? Just to compute the factor here. That's all. You can guess the fact that this factor is only depending on the density ratio, but you have to find what is this factor. And now, you are doing a very involved calculation for very few things. You know, some physicists will stay at this stage, say, okay, I have understood the problem. Just a student, go to compute. You will see. The calculation I will develop this calculation because it is instructive for you. I cannot develop all the calculation, but this one I want to develop. Okay. So now be careful. I am working now in the reference frame of the planar unperturbed plane. You know, I'll be back to this. U and W now are the component on the x-axis and y-axis in this reference frame. So be careful, it's different. And I the front, and I am working in two dimensions. This is not a problem, huh? Just for simplicity. And I will denote the frame surface as an equation like x function alpha of y and t. This is the equation of the frame surface. I want to find an equation for that. Okay, this is my objective, is to find the equation of this surface. All right? Okay, I have to recall you a simple result on differential geometry. You see, this, if alpha denotes the x equal alpha yt denotes the front, the equation of the front, the normal to the front, and f is for at the front, this normal, the component is simply these two terms here, where alpha prime y is the derivative, a partial derivative with respect to the transverse coordinate. Okay, now the normal velocity, you know, you contract this flow velocity with the normal, and you have immediately this expression for the normal velocity. This is the expression of the normal. Here it is nonlinear. This is exact. It's not. I do not use a linear approximation here because I may need this jump later in the nonlinear case. For the tangential, it is the same because when you have I did not write here the component of the tangential, but it is directly. So you obtain this relation for the component relation. So, all right. Now, what about the normal velocity of the front? The normal velocity of the front is the time is a derivative with respect to the partial derivative with respect to time of this alpha divided by this geometrical factor, which is simply the inclination of the where you are. Okay. What is important is to now to use the boundary to use the jump condition in the correct reference frame. That is the reference frame of the frame. So I need to know what is the flow velocity relative to the perturbed front. And this is simply in the normal component is the normal component of the flow minus the normal velocity of the front. It is written here. This is this expression. And this is a tangential expression, which is conserved on both sides, as I show you. Now, I apply the conservation equation, the jump across the frame of the normal flow velocity should be, I have to tell you that I have changed notation. I use minus denotes the fresh mixture here and plus denote the burn mixture because I will use this for different interface, different from flame. So flame, I use U and B, but okay, this is just change of notation. So if you use conservation of mass, you have this relation here. Now, conservation of momentum, you have the two components. One u square here, it's normal, is this in the normal direction, and the tangential direction is here. So here are the equation that you obtain in term of the equation of the frame front. That obtained from the equation for the frame front coming from the jump across the frame considered as an hydrodynamic discontinuity, again, when the thickness of the frame is neglected, is zero. So now, in order to obtain an equation for the frame, I have to solve the flow on both sides. And the flow satisfies a layer equation. But because I am interested in the stability analysis, I am interested in small disturbances, and I will consider small disturbances, and I want to know what is the feature of these small disturbances, all right? So I am going to linearize the problem, because when something is small, something, the same thing square is even smaller than something, all right? So what does that mean? I mean, I will take only the linear disturbances and I neglect the nonlinear term. And this is a big simplification. It's a drastic simplification of the equation, and you may solve this problem. Because the nonlinear problem of Euler equation, for example, you cannot solve analytically like that. It's much more difficult. You cannot solve, in fact. So except in some limiting case, I am going to explain you this later. Now, I introduce the over bar here to denote the steady state, the initial state which is steady, planar frame. Yes, this is denoted by an over bar. And then every quantity is developed as an unperturbed value plus a perturbed value delta. And this, I will neglect all the delta square compared to the delta, because I assume that delta A is small compared to overline A. All right? So here now are the equation, Euler equation. You know, I have had for further reason that I will use later, I have had the hydrostatic pressure coming from the difference of density, coming from the variation of height what I did here, and even though I put an acceleration that depends on time, because this, I am going to use that later on, you will see. So it's just, forget this subtlety here and consider pi as the pressure, all right? Forget about that. So it's the pressure. Here are the Euler equation in the linear form. Now the u square that you have, u grad u that you have in Euler equation becomes simply a derivative, a space derivative of the perturbation times the unperturbed velocity. All right? Is that clear? Or do I have to? Okay. Just I want to be sure. Everybody, you see what I am written here? Okay. If I have u square, for example, and u is u overline plus delta u. Delta u is small in compared to u overline. I take the square. I have three terms. All right. I neglect, this is an unperturbed solution. This is a linear perturbation, linear in delta u, and I neglect the square. You can do that for u grad u, it's the same. You know, you can do exactly the same for this. No problem, you know. It's an exercise, okay? You understand? So I linearize the Euler equation. And here is a linear form. And because, and in this linear form, you know, this term is rho u bar. But this rho u bar at the frame, this is why there is f here, it is at the frame, is the same on both sides, conservation of mass. So this is the same. Now, the difference of side is coming only from the rho that you have in front of the derivative. You know, when you have now a term like rho d over dt a, this in linear will come rho d over dt delta a. Why? Because a, or the u here, I don't care, is only one that depends on t. bar does not depend on t. All right? So this is why you have here. Oh, excuse me. Ah! This is why you have here the unperturbed density. And the only difference between the fresh mixture and the burn, on the fresh side and the burn side, is coming from this difference of density that you have on an unsteady term. All right? And also in pressure. No, there is no difference coming from the rho u, because rho u is the same. So from the factor in front of the space derivative or the derivative with respect to space is the same coefficient. All right. Now, it is easy to obtain an equation, a linear equation, for the pressure. What you do, simply, you are going to use the continuity equation. You take the derivative with respect to x of the first equation, the derivative with respect to y of the second equation, and you add. The left-hand side is going to disappear because this is zero, dx delta u plus dy delta w gives zero. So you, the left-hand side goes zero, then you obtain what? The Laplace, in that case, I have written that in 3D, but in 2D, you have only the two first. You end up with the Laplace equation for the pressure. Okay? Who can... Just a question to see if someone of you will know the answer. What will become this equation if I am compressible? Excuse?
Source term.
Source term? Yeah. What kind of equation do you obtain? Poisson equation. Yes, you are called the Poisson equation. The wave equation, you obtain the wave equation of the acoustics. All right? Okay, I see that maybe I can go a little bit faster. No? I don't know. Because, yeah. So, very good, very good. So this, you know, when you neglect, in fact, in this, if I was compressible, I would obtain in the second derivative with time, u, and I will have the square of the sound velocity. But because the square of sound velocity is infinite, the second derivative in time disappears in front of the second derivative in space. Okay? Good. Now, it's when you have such an equation, it's good to look for solution in the form of harmonic disturbances. What does that mean? That means that you, in the transverse direction, you use sinus and cosinus development, like as usual for this kind of problem. And so that when you have a quantity which is a field here that depends on both longitudinal and transverse direction, the coefficient here depends only on time and the longitudinal direction, and all the transverse direction are put in the exponential cosine and sine plus I sine thing. And k is a wave number, okay? Okay, this is a Fourier. You may use a Fourier decomposition. You may use a sum over all the wavelengths of these things. But because the problem is linear, each term of this sum satisfies the equation. So I forget the sum. All right? So what I know, I will know the wavelength. This will be given. And I want to have an equation for the front with that. Okay, now it's when you, the Laplace equation here, every time you derive in the transverse direction, you know, you multiply by ik twice, you multiply by minus k square. So what do you obtain here? You obtain the now your your pi here, this is delta pi, this is tilde pi depending on x and t. So this pi now here depend only on x and t, and here is the equation. This is the second, the transverse derivative here that gives you this term, minus k squared. Now, this solution can be integrated immediately. Why? Because I forgot to tell you what are the boundary conditions. The boundary condition is such that at minus infinity, I have no disturbances. And I am, and in the boundary on the outside, I don't write zero. Does anyone know why I don't write zero? Okay. Someone? Not so bad. No, you are very close. Vorticity. Who remember how the vorticity is propagated? Vorticity is propagated in Euler equation how? By the flow. The vorticity propagates with the flow. It turns out that the change of density is going to create vorticity in the burned gas. You cannot create vorticity in the fresh mixture for one reason, is that upstream there is no vorticity because you are zero perturbation. And if you convect zero, it's zero. But when you cross the flame, you create vorticity. And this is why I do not put zero, because for the flow velocity, it will not be zero. I have to take into account the vorticity. But for the pressure, it does not mind, because the vorticity is isopressure. There is no pressure in the vessel. So now what I said in the burn gas, the disturbance has to remain finite. It is impossible to diverge, all right? This is my condition. In such a way, the solution of this equation here, second order differential equation, is simply this result with a minus sign for the fresh mixture, because in minus infinity, it's just the opposite. Minus sign is for the burned gases, because when x go to plus infinity, I should go to zero, and the plus sign is to the plus sign here is to minus the fresh mixture, because when I go upwards, I have to go to zero. So there is no choice. The choice is here. So minus plus is for plus minus, right? Now you know the pressure. You know the pressure in terms of function of time. So, okay, you know the pressure as a function of time at the front. For the flow velocity, you use the continuity equation, and you use this equation. And now you have such an equation here, which is written where I have put in the right-hand side the result that I have obtained for the pressure, okay? Because this is a first derivative with respect to space of this term, and you have a plus minus k that goes down here, okay? Because you take the derivative. So now you have an equation, linear equation, with a source term here. How can you solve this equation usually? Okay. So when you have an homogeneous differential equation, this is first order differential equation with a source term, the general solution can be written in the form of the general solution of the homogeneous equation without this term, plus a particular solution, if I am able to find a particular solution. And this is a general, and then I have to apply the boundary condition and I determine the two parts. So R here is for the homogeneous equation. And this is why it is R, because it is going to become the rotational part that I have talked about. This is why I put R. And P, why I put P, because it is potential. There is no rotational part in P, you will see. So now the rotational part has to satisfy the homogeneous equation. It is written here. This is so. Yes, OK. And the potential part now, I will use a particular solution, looking for a solution of the same type as the pressure. You see? Exactly at the same time, so that when I put that on this equation, the term exponential minus plus kx vanish, is simplified, and I obtain an equation, a simple equation for first order derivation in time, and it is an ODE equation, ordinary differential equation now, for the quantity, the function up here, which is the amplitude of this thing, depending only on time, with the source term, which is due to say. Okay, so now I have to say few words about this term here. So here now, here again are the two potential parts that I have obtained with two unknown function of time and exponential kx for the minus side on the fresh side, minus kx on the burned side to go to zero at infinity. Okay, this is the same thing. K is the wave number. Now, what about this equation? What's the general solution of this equation? Propagation without deformation. Okay, what does that mean? That means it is function of only one variable, which is x minus velocity time. All right? So this here it is written. This is a general solution of this equation, propagation without deformation. All right? And now, because on the minus infinity I have zero, this term, tilde u, should be zero on the cold side. There is no rotational path on the cold side. Now, on the hot side, you don't know exactly what is going to happen. I tell you, vorticity is going to be created at the surface. So I have to introduce a new function of time here, u, low capital R, x depending on time, so that the general solution of this is depending on t and r, and x is this form. So you have a new function depending on time, which is tilde u low cap r. So for the moment, this is a form. So you have three unknown functions. Uf, which is a potential part at the flame of the upstream, and this is dependent on time. You have the potential part at the flame of the burned gas, function of time again, and you have a rotational part coming from this. So you have three unknown function of x for the moment. And you have another unknown, which is the flame surface, okay? The evolution of the flame surface. So you have four unknown, and you want to determine all of them. So you need four equations. And where these four equations are coming from? Jump condition at the flame, okay? I have to use now the jump conditions at the flame, because these are simply the solution of the Euler equation upstream and downstream. I did not use for the moment the jump condition. So here I have written the flow field in terms of these three functions here. This is the Euler equation upstream. This is the Euler equation downstream here. Okay, with the potential part, and you have the potential and the rotational part here. In the pressures, you have only the potential part. So now, the flow, you know, I have, in order to obtain, I use a continuity equation here to relate the tangential, this is for the longitudinal flow, and the tangential flow is given simply by the continuity equation, d over dx u plus d over dy w, and in that, in the form Fourier form, it gives you this solution where I have used here the derivative of u minus in x give you k here. All right, this k is coming from the derivative du over dx. This is dy over dy. Okay. So you have now four boundary conditions at the front. The four boundary conditions. You have two equations for the conservation of mass. And this is a little bit subtle. Why I have two? Because each of the mass flux cannot vary. Why? Because I have assumed that the flame thickness is zero. So I have assumed that I do not perturb the inner structure of the flame. If I do not perturb the inner structure of the flame, locally the flame is planar. Okay? And just to show you, maybe I have to be back to show you the picture. Okay, here. Okay, so locally I have this picture. Locally, I should have this picture because I am planar. What does that mean? That means that the velocity here cannot change, should be the same. You cannot change the velocity, all right? And so this is going to give you three conditions. Two conditions, excuse me. Where I am? I am lost? No, later. Okay. Okay, I have two conditions. One is the mass flux upstream should be zero. The second one is mass flux downstream should be zero. This is two equations, all right? It's not only one equation, two equations. So they're two, and now I have also two equations for the conservation of the normal and tangential momentum. So my problem is set, is all set, is well posed. It's just a game now to find the answer. And you know how the answer is going to be. It's going to be to a linear growth rate proportional to UA, to the flame velocity times the modulus of the wave vector. So, but just the coefficient. We are going to obtain this coefficient. That's all. But it is very instructive to do this exercise because it will be useful for the following lectures. So now I use a boundary condition at the front. You see, I use that this should be zero, this should be zero. What does that mean? Delta U minus should be equal to delta U plus just in front of the flame behind, and both should be equal to the derivative of the alpha with respect to t. I remember you that x equal alpha y. I use only one transverse. This is the equation of the front, okay? Just to keep you that in mind. All right. So now I have this, and I have written the two equations here. Oh, excuse me. Ah, okay. And now this is when I use now. This is the same as this one equation. using now the decomposition that I have using the Fourier transform and the condition pressure. In the burn side, you have the potential plus the rotational part, and this is the upstream velocity. And this should be equal to the first derivative of the alpha. I put a lower bar, just to remind you that this is a vector usually, not necessarily here, but it is not modulus of k. This is what I want to say. It is not modulus of k. It is a wave. The wavelength is a vector. All right. This can be give you a relation that I'm going to use. Concerning the derivative, I derive once more with respect to time. I'm going to use this. For the tangential component, I use the derivative. It's better to use the transverse derivative of the transverse component for convenience. So here it's the equation for this, so I may go fast here. So if you apply now this, using this expression, you find such an expression here, which is obtained from the tangential component. Now, if you eliminate now this d, the derivative with respect to time of tilde u low cap hair here, you eliminate this, if you put this in it, you obtain this relation for the potential part. Okay? Now let's go to the last jump condition, which is the conservation of the normal component. And you notice that I have linearized here. You see, this is the linearization of the square of the velocity. When you linearize the square of the velocity like here, you see, là, you obtain this factor 2 here and the linear part. And because it is a relative velocity relative to the front, okay? This is why you have dot alpha t here, because the velocity that you have to put here is the velocity relative to the front that is going to cross. Okay, but now, because I have this relation here, this term disappears. So I have equality of the pressure. But you know, here, the difference of in pi here is coming from the fact that I have used an acceleration, longitudinal acceleration g. And for further reason, I will make it depending on time, you will see why. But this is, you may forget that, equality of pressure for the moment. Now, you use the solution, and you using now this equality of pressure here, you find another relation. So you have a relation and another one here. And this, now, this tilde u prime f is equal to here, the derivative of alpha with respect to time, that I am going to use it. Same here, in this equation here. And now you eliminate this, the left-hand side here. You put this equal to that. And what do you obtain? A wonderful equation for alpha tilde alpha t. Second order differential equation. Here, you know, second derivative, first derivative, and then a term which is proportional to tilde alpha. So this is a linear equation that you obtain. Does this equation remind you something? Not. Some. for example, suppose, consider the case where you have an interface, which is, what is an interface? Is a surface across which there is no flow. For example, separating an interface, separating liquid and gas, okay? What is, because you may apply this, this is okay, this works perfectly. I have just to kill the mass flux, M. So you have just to kill this M here. And what is this equation now? Does this equation that remind you something? But in physics, what kind of experiment? A bubble rising in a tube. Why? Okay, this I'll tell you now that this. So this is the equation I have obtained, and I kill the mass flux, and I have the Rayleigh-Taylor instability when you have a heavy fluid above a light fluid. Or when you have, and this is going to give you, for example, the solution of the bubble, the Taylor bubble. Okay. So if I work in Fourier mode now, so I am looking for a solution in that form where sigma is now a complex number whose real part gives you the growth rate and the imaginary part gives you the frequency of oscillation. Is that okay? Okay for everybody? If I use this and I am linearly unstable if the real part is positive, all right? So now I put this in it and I obtain the Rayleigh-Taylor instability telling you that the square of the growth rate coming from this term here, second derivative, is balanced by the gravity term here. Okay? Okay, now assume that the gravity is constant. So you have this, and now you obtain the Rayleigh-Taylor bubble and the Rayleigh-Taylor instability. Okay, you have to go through a nonlinear equation. This is very... my advice is that you have to do to solve this problem as Rayleigh-Taylor did for the bubble. It's a very interesting nonlinear problem. Very easy. Look to the book of Landau-Lifschitz, for example, in field mechanics. You have that solution. You do by yourself as an exercise to find out the form of the tip of this bubble and the velocity, the rising velocity of the bubble. You may guess that by dimensional analysis also, that it should be g times the radius of the tube, but square root. But okay, but to find the number, it's a little bit more difficult. So this is a Rayleigh-Taylor instability. And I note, as every time you obtain a result, you have to check the dimension. And this is correct because g is an acceleration. It is a length divided by a time square. Multiplied by a length is the inverse of the time square. Square root of t is the inverse of the time. Inverse of the time is a growth rate or a damping rate. So I am OK. So I check. My check is OK. So OK with the dimension. And now if I just do the opposite, I put the light liquid above the heavy one, what do I have? The gravity waves, the waves. In fact, these waves were described by Newton already, by a strange, you know. And this wave, you have the oscillatory frequency of this wave, which is given here, which is also now, which is because it is. There is something wrong here. Huh? Dimension is wrong. Because, dimension is right. Because this is the frequency. So, maybe something is wrong here. This is right. longer square divided longer divided by the time square multiplied by the length is the long length k square divided by the time square takes the square root is the velocity. Okay, I said something wrong just before. And here you have the frequency, the oscillation frequency of the wave what is called gravity waves, which works like square root of g acceleration k wave number. So when you have wave, as soon as you have the wave number, you know the oscillatory frequency. Okay, it's maybe time to have a 10-minute break. Okay.